Sehr gerne, Sani.
Okay. Let's talk a bit about Lincoln, how it works, and how you can modify it, and what we plan for the future to improve it. That's essentially these three sections in another order. First, I will talk about how it works. Then I will tell some things that we discussed that we want to improve in the future. And if I have still time left by then, I'm not very good at timing as some might know. I will talk about how you normally fix bugs in Lincoln. So if you want to do it, you can do it right and cost less work for us. So, a short explanation of the history of Lincoln. Lincoln is by the old package. It's started in 1998 by Christian Schwarz and Richard Brackmann. Oh, something simpler. The much of the code is still from then, and this is sometimes it's a hindrance for the development, which was probably one of the things why Linda was started some time. The other thing might be that it's in Perl and some people don't like it. It has switched maintainers fairly often. I have listed a short. I have put together a short list of all the maintainers that it had. Currently, we have switched to a maintainer group, which is Jeroen, me, and Mark. Other people like Colin Watson or Joey Hess also have been or are still regularly contributing, but are not maintainers as such. It's currently in the subversion repository on the private server, but it's planned to move that to an LH project. The LH project already exists, but Joy is still listed as the admin. So we can't change it at the moment. If you want to have access to the repository, it's very easy. You can do it in an automated request the account in an automated way on svm.ml. But let's see how Lincoln works. We have the Lincoln front end, which calls a lot of other scripts that are in different directories, either in the source or in the installed state in user share Lincoln. It's user share, yeah. We have an unpack phase where we unpack this deps or the source package and to make it usable by the other scripts essentially, and we extract some information from the changes file from the DC what we have. Then we have the connection scripts that are scripts that try to find information like running a file on all files that we have extracted, running object dump on all the DAF files that we have unpacked, things like that, or just searching for files like for all main pages or things like that. So the work that you can really see them is done by the scripts and checks that will then use this information that is available to try to find errors in the package. The output can be piped then to Lincoln info, which is done automatically if you call it with the minus E switch, which will post-process the output a bit and make it more informative. A bit more into detail about each phase. In the unpicking phase, we have different levels. That is, I think that was is still from the beginning of LinkedIn and is merely a performance thing, I think. So if you only want to run some checks, it is often not needed to unpack the full package. And so it would be faster if you don't have to unpick it full. But I've never seen anybody run LinkedIn with these, all these options, like run only this check or something like that. So it's probably, I think, it's always unpacked to level 2 in any normal run. So it's not really necessary anymore. But I mean, the code is there and it works. So yeah, we will only change it if it's really necessary. But yes, we first, for binary packages, we first unpack the control tar. I have left out the suffix because nowadays I think you can could change it even, not in the archive, but in inofficial packages. And LinkedIn should support also these two files. Yeah, it unpacks the control tar. So the Debian directory generates an index of the files in the data tar. So it basically calls debuggage deb minus c or tar minus t or something like that. Level 2 then unpacks the full package, similar to the debuggage deb minus x, I think. Yeah. For source packages, one only extracts the information from the DSC 3-4 months in, and level 2 then adjusts call the package source minus x on the source package. So we now come to the connection scripts. For checks and for connection scripts, we have always two files. One file is the script itself, and the other file is the description file. I've given you an example here. This description file is typical Debian control file from the format and just lists some info, especially some meta info like the author, which might be nice to know. But the important part is that it lists the type, so that it will not, the script will not be called if you test the source package and the collection is only makes only sense for binary packages, and it states the required unpack level, and it can also indicate that it has to be run after another connection script because it uses information from there. So it is order 2 means almost all connection scripts have order 1 stating there, and this one will only be called in the second pass, and it requires that the file info connection script is run before. This is needed because you can decide that you only want to run some connection scripts, and this is some kind of dependency anyway. The connection script for this, for example, is only a shell script that runs over the file list and calls object dump on each elf file. The check scripts have similar description files, but there are more information in it. The type unpack level needs info is similar, but we have also done then the tags where the name of the tag is referenced in the check itself, but only other info, like is it an error or running or info, and the extended info that you can print off with built-in info, it's all in the description file, so that's not mixed with the code. I have put here a simple example for a checking script. It's a normal Perl module. Previously it was Perl scripts, but we changed it to Perl modules so that we can just include them instead of having to fork and exit the script, and which is just a waste of time. We plan this to do for the connection scripts too. It uses some internal libraries, support libraries, which essentially give you the ability to output the text. It then opens depth-files control, which was generated by a connection script, and it's just the normal control file. I have only extracted one of the checks here, one of the texts. The original script is longer and has more checks. You can see that it just loops over the file and searches for duplicated fields. Nothing very interesting. Should be sensitive to no Perl, otherwise it's probably too fast now to understand. So, after that, you can pipe the info, this only outputs these normal output you normally see if you run Lintian, like error, tag name, and some more info about where you found the error or what the problem in question really was. And you can type it then to Lintian info, which adds these extended infos where we describe the problem in detail and tell you what you can do against it, which just takes the text from the description file and strips out HTML text, which we use so that we can use the same descriptions on the lintian.demon.org. And perhaps the next description. Nothing very interesting, it's a very short script only, but could probably be extended to be much more useful. But more on this now in the further development section. Questions so far?
I have a question.
Yeah.
Can you go back to the example from the collection script or description? Why do you need, for one thing you have dependencies like needs info, file info, and you have something like the target, which is object dump info. Why do you also need the order thing?
I honestly don't know. I didn't check the code, if it's really needed anymore. I don't know if it your thing was added before. I don't know. I will have to check the code.
It probably saves you from doing to have to compute partial ordering.
Yeah, but you have to do that anyway.
No, you don't have to.
It could be used as a statement like, okay, this has dependencies and
And then too late to figure out which one, so just write it after the other stuff.
Yeah, and. The needs info is not used then probably if you choose to only run certain checks and certain connection scripts, so that only the need that the needed ones are run even then if you so that you can't break it by collecting the wrong set. I guess it's something like that. I think this code we really never touched. The most work was done on the checks stuff in the last year. further down the road. First of all, like we have seen right now in this discussion about the order thing, the code is pretty old, and there are things like stuff that is written in many, many lines of code, which can nowadays just use a more modern Perl feature and can be written in one line. And then the stuff that that we are run all of the scripts with exec, but it's all Perl. I think we have one bash script also in the middle somewhere, but it, that could be easily converted to Perl, and it, it's probably way faster if you just include the whole thing and instead having to fork like 30, 40 times just for one package. Also, because if we would use modules all the time, we could pass objects in memory around and would probably save some of the many file reads. We just, the collection scripts should essentially dump all the things to files, and the text files, check scripts just read them again, which is also a very good waste of time. We essentially especially when the check scripts have to pass the info again. So that's, but that's the kind of stuff, it works, and if you don't have the time, you don't really want to touch it, and then have to deal with all the records you've already introduced at the beginning. Also, the front end code is really horrible. It's just a really long Perl script, which is very unordered, and we have some code that is at a certain point, and we don't know why it's there.
You should remove it and see what happens.
And it's all the stuff that is used for checking internet mode, where you can check a whole archive and things, and this whole code is not very good separated from the code that you only need to run it on a single package, and things like that. It works, but it could be way more maintainable. So, but that's under the in the section, if we have time sometime. Another thing is, the current code that generates the temporary directory where the collection scripts dump the info and the check scripts get the info from, and it's, we all find it very horrible, and it is not the whole structure of the lab is very complex, and if you are new to Unity and want to write a new check, it costs some time to understand where to find the info, and the code that generates Unity.ubin.org has to run over the whole lab, and and the index is in a very weird format, and there's also a now good storage of the information which results have the last checks have given. So the lint-db.org currently uses a single log file where it just appends the current one, where it only runs over the new packages, so it doesn't have to check the archive each day. So it only runs over the new packages and then passes the whole log file again to generate the HTML pages. That is something that's probably in very big need of a simple database and not this very long file that is
fun.
And
when I'm reading lab code, I'm always confused. Is there a big difference on running Lintian on a single package and on the whole archive?
Not really.
It sounds like it's a whole different thing.
No,
because I don't have a lab at home if I run Lintian on a single package.
No, The lab is the next. Okay, I should have explained this in more detail. The lab is just the name used in the code for the directory where all the information is dumped into. If you run it on a single package, it's just, or a list of packages, it's just a temporary directory that gets generated, all the info the collection scripts is dumped there, and afterwards it's deleted after the checks are run. You can make a static lab so that it dumps the info and the unpacked packages, and if you run it then again on the same lab, it checks whether the packages have changed, and if they don't have changed, it doesn't check them again.
How does it know
the
packages have changed?
The package is still there. I think it deletes the unpacked level 2 stuff, like the whole dev and the whole source package, but it, the info about the version number and the architecture and stuff like that remains.
Does it compare the file sums or so? Because the version number doesn't help me if I'm running it at home, but because I'm developing.
Yeah. Okay. I don't think it checks MD5 sums. It only checks the version number, and it just assumes that the archive is the same enough that not two files with the same version number and the same architecture, but different contents are allowed in the archive. I think it's actually not that same. You can break it, but. That's a very rare case. I believe you have to upload a package and then delete it from unstable. Yes. And then it has happened at one occasion, but it was it was not Lindy that broke over it. It was something other.
Yeah,
but it was very interesting. It was uploaded then without the content. Yeah.
Okay.
Currently, there is a hack in place to use the information from the source package while checking the binary package, which is needed, for example, to guess if we forget it. But that's not used very good, and it's not very reliable. It just creates siblings in the lab and. Yeah, it's very good. So, one thing we want to have is that the whole lab gets more structured and more documented at the first step, and that the whole logging code of old results that could be used in further ones needs also some work. Now to a completely different topic, user interaction. Currently, Lindian only sorts its output in three classes. It's either an info, a warning, or an error. These three classes are somewhat defined. It should be an error is somewhat like in SC bug. It's a policy violation or a similar thing, like it will probably cause a failure to read from source, even if it isn't a policy violation, things like that. A warning should be everything else, and info should be used for things that are only cosmetic. But we have downgraded some errors to warnings because they have too many false positives, and we don't want to give people complain about it. Oh, my package has Lindian errors, but it's not true. And will I get an RC bug? And things like that. So the idea is to give people a hint, a better hint. What we first of all, what the severity is like now, but give the information about how sure we are that this check is reliable in the second dimension, do not intermix this information so that you, right now you have a warning that can either mean it's a very severe violation, but we are not sure, or it can mean, it's not so important. Also, this is a good chance to go over all the categorization and check, because there are some things that are very weird severities right now, because it was growing over time, and different people have used different, have different opinions on what the right severity is, and each maintainer has tweaked that a bit, and yeah, nobody has gone over all the hundreds of Lindian errors and checked if they are consistently judged. So my current plan is, it's actually my pet project of all the ones that I present you here, to have two dimensions. One, the severity, which should work like right now, but should probably get one or two more categories, like we will divide between policy violation, severe error that is not really a policy, this is not covered by policy, warning, cosmetic changes, things like that. Probably four categories or five. And the second dimension will be significance, should be. Let's not talk about things I haven't written yet. We can indicate, so it would be categories like, we're sure. we're sure, but we have seen false positives on this check. And things like, could be and could be not, like 50% of the time we are right. Thanks.
Can we have it classified in a way that we can follow the checked uploads based on that?
We can work on that we can. So since it's not written, it's very flexible. but we can talk about it beforehand so that it's implemented in a way that's helpful for you. One thing I was thinking about when messing with the code that outputs the text, one could also think about making two different outputs, one for humans to read, which would be probably very similar to that that we have right now. The idea was perhaps to use such things like question mark after the error to indicate that we're not sure. Let's see how we get this right. And perhaps something for other scripts, like the whole QA page, the developer PHP, the PTS, things like that, that we can produce a more convenient format for them to pass them, like XML, FC, A22, don't know. Right now it's not, you have very defined that first comes the severity, then comes the package, then comes the tag name, but everything else is very undefined, what comes after that. And so, especially if we introduce these two dimensions of rating errors, the parser would probably be more complex and it would be easier to just use another format.
Another idea for that file that you're like machine readable file is that you use Lindian minus I and that file as an input, and then you get a complete list of the errors that it was producing.
My idea was just as you get a new option to Lindian, just output format or something like that, and then the library that currently issues the text can then decide on this option whether it, which output format it generates.
But I mean that could be used also, like when you usually get the Lindian output, you just get a one-liner.
Yeah.
So that you can like feed Lindian with that, and then you get the complete description of all the errors. So you can just pass that information to someone else instead of having to run the complete Lindian.
Yeah, you can do it as well now. You can put the one-liner into Lindian info, and then only add the description, and you could, of course, this would then have to be extended to support all the output formats.
Okay.
that would be, it should be no problem. Okay. So I think we'll start with this slide. Yeah, another thing that is more and more visible with more people interested in PHP. A lot of tools right now. Let's talk about the latter point first. We have currently a lot of tools like Lintian, Linder. You can use Deptiv to search for some obvious errors in your packages. Compared with the previous versions, we have PewParts, which was written not so long ago by Lars Vicentius. And these are all not integrated into each other, or there's no front end to run them all. And that's one thing, that's, I think it's a useful project for someone to, first of all, write a front end so that you just say, oh, I have this package just built, please run all of the checks you have on it and just tell me if it's okay. That's one thing that would be really useful. I mean, I'm probably not the only one that has a homegrown bash script at home that essentially does this, but it depends too much on my build environment setup and things like that, and it's probably it would be useful if someone tries to find a way to make this on a higher abstraction level so that everyone can use it. I find that all the tools find very different errors. Especially Deptiv is very useful to check for things like misbuilds where you you lose some library dependencies out of nowhere, so there's probably something wrong. And or you lose all your files, probably something wrong. And this is errors that Lintian or Linda will never be able to detect because they have no history. They can only see the package, and if it's empty, okay, you probably wanted it to be empty. If it says no user share doc, okay, we can say that's against policy. But if you have no binaries, yeah, you probably don't need any. Yeah? But if you write that diff and the binaries, you see all the binaries in, only in the first package, but in my new compiled package, it's lost. And you see its error. So these are very different kind of errors that are detected. What we can would be able to do is, but probably the other way around. PewParts, for instance, checks installation. Some things Lintian or Linda can't detect, because the package isn't installed. If it's installed, we can check for things like broken siblings. We can't do that if it's not installed, because it might just have a dependency that fixes the sibling. Or it will run it in the post and fix the sibling. So there's checks, and especially all the dynamic library checks. Oh, it depends on both flip. C6 and C7, like, or standard C++5 and 6. We can't detect this because in the uninstalled state it hasn't any library. Or you can't reliably judge it because the dependencies are not installed. So, one thing that would be perhaps useful would be to allow to run something like Lintian. I'm not sure how many code you can share between it, but it would be useful to find it out in PewParts, because the package is then installed, and you can run these checks, and it of course all the checks have to be written, because they are not yet written, because we can't check this, but it would probably be possible to use some of the unpacking collection stuff that we already have, so that we don't have to write a new program from the ground for this. Yeah, it was also avoid. Yeah, what comes out if you try to hack these checks in. You can see it in Lynda. I was very disappointed by this one. So we will tell it. it checks whether, it tries to find out whether you have linked against two versions of a library. But if you have built, the problem is with the current C++ transition, the library names doesn't change, only the package names. So if you have built in a change route, and on your build system the old version is still installed, it gets full wrong results because it tries to match the library name file names, and these are still the same. But the dependencies will ensure that if the package is really installed, it will not break, and it will not depend on two different versions of the library. So, yeah, that's other things that would be very interesting would be to enhance the unpacked code to be able to handle. Yeah, I've seen it. like unpacked source packages, because it's essentially what we do, we unpack the source package. So you should be able to check an unpacked source package by just copying it and without having to first pack it. Okay, I have only 5 minutes left, so I will probably skip the part I have now intended. Let's talk about this slide, though. It's if you want to help with Linkian, it's always the first step to report something like, oh, my check, the check detects a false positive, or let's add this check. The most possibility that it really gets implemented if you provide patch. I wanted to show what a really good patch would be for Lintian for a certain bug, but it's probably not that time anymore. So if you want to see it, it talks a bit about the test suite we have and things like that, check the slides and talk with the maintainer. But I don't have the time anymore. What's also very useful, if you can't provide a patch, if you do a wishlist bug and want to add a new check, but you can't write the patch because you don't speak Perl, or you don't have the time. What is really useful, and if you have the time, do it please, already think of a sort of an algorithm how to check it. Because it's not always obvious how to come from a problem to a check. Especially to a check that is useful and doesn't produce too many false positives. So if you give us an algorithm and how you can check it, like you have to go to the list of files and search for this pattern, and coding that in Perl is not a problem. There's mailing list. So if you want to be informed about what's happening in development, or help to discuss the broader changes I discussed, just subscribe to it. It's just a normal Debian mailing list. Lintian mailed at debian.org is just the old address and goes through this mailing list by now. So you get all the maintainer mails, like bug reports and stuff like that there too. But anyway, it's not that high volume, so. Okay, let's see. All the other stuff is like only the patch for the specific bug. Okay, then I think I'm finished here. Further questions?
Do you think there are checks you do on the actual data, not a bit of the package which you will not do on the start package? I wonder if there are checks you do on the just data of the package which you could not do when the package is installed. I think you should be able to do all the checks on the contents. in the control panel is lost. But also it's not more really lost, but it's harder to get to.
Okay, you can do them all, but it's not added value. Okay.
Well, it's then, because you can integrate it with a few parts code.
Okay, you can. Okay, your point is that you can just save one then, because if you run it on a sort package, you already should probably be. Yeah, I see no problem right now with it, because what we do is essentially. What we essentially do is package minus minus x and good.
Yeah.
The only thing is. The other thing is the maintainer can then can fuck up a bit a certain check because he do stupid things in postings. That would be the only difference, but it's probably not that common.
And there is another disadvantage of that. If you want to run it on an installed package, then you need the correct architecture. And if you just unpack it, you can do that on any architecture.
No, the point was not that it. The point is, if you would run it on an installed package, it would be useful to run all the checks because you don't have to run it twice then.
Yeah.
The point was just, if you run Lintian and then PU parts installed the package and run Lintian again, that would be not useful because you can all run, you can all do all the checks you have done in the first one in the second one too.
Except the stuff that's done on the source.
Yeah, of course. The source package, but we don't do anything on installed source packages. Okay. Other questions? Okay, then I'm done.
Let me catch my